Starting in the early modern period, around 1700, new imports from Europe came into the Mughal courts, along with many of these new luxuries that the Mughal emperors adored was glass. And at that time, in the first half of the 17th century, really starting from Emperor Jahangir's period, we start seeing illustrations and paintings that show glass goblets and the like included in these paintings. One such famous example is the Emperor Jahangir with the Iranian ambassador Shah Abbas. And as you see in this painting, there is a small goblet seated in the front with other luxury goods. Objects of this type were most certainly foreign imports that probably came from either Italy or England and were of a soda lime silica variety. However, the first official court record appears in 1604 in the Mughal court chronicles of Emperor Akbar. And this account comes from a Persian envoy named Asad Beg, who is forever immortalized in history as the man who introduced tobacco to the Mughal court. We believe that the first form and shape of smoking devices actually replicated that of a coconut, which was indigenous and widely found across the Indian subcontinent. However, at some point after that, the form shifts and it takes on what becomes a uniquely Indian shape of hookah base, which is a spherical or a globular shape, essentially rounded. And we have early Mughal paintings dated to around 1650 that show men and women smoking hookah bases of this shape. We also know that the form, before we find it in glass, existed in beadery, in metalwork, and possibly even porcelain that was being introduced from China. We also know, based on Ravenscroft's distinct vertical ribbing, that these hookah bases appear, in particular, in paintings that depict Raja Kirpal of Basoli, dated to 1690. This is recorded in East India Office records, where they were importing, already in the late 17th century, hukka bases, or what they called Hubble-Bubbles. By the second half of the 18th century, we see illustrations clearly that have glass hukka bases. And why do we know this? Well, we can see the stem illustrated in detail throughout the transparency of the glass. We also have a wonderful painting dated again to the second half of the 18th century from Murshidabad that shows a green hookah base, a woman smoking it, with detailed glass florets or stylized leaves around it. And this is one of the earliest paintings that clearly indicates as well that she is smoking a glass hookah base. And this leads now to perhaps my personal favorite, and this piece is actually made free blown of an emerald green glass and has an exquisite pattern done in the reverse gilt technique of serrated leaves, beautifully and evenly placed all around the hookah base. This exquisite glass piece is probably part of a group of only six other known emerald glass hookah bases, but is by far one of my favorite specimens given its condition. It arrived into the Victoria and Albert Museum collection in 1930. Now, this piece is probably dated to the first half of the 18th century. And how do we know that this is actually an Indian glass hookah base versus another? There are certain technical features that actually help to distinguish the two. While both are of a spherical shape, the main difference actually comes to the rim around the neck. On most English and European examples, this rim has actually been added externally. On Indian examples, it's part of the actual neck. And if you put your finger inside of the rim, you can feel a slight indentation. This is an actual indication that I have realized on all hookah bases, irrespective of date, that prove that they're an Indian manufacturer. Why this difference, I still don't know, but it is one of the strong features. But around 1730, we start seeing variations in hookah bases forms, with the base actually rounding out to form what is called a bell-shaped hookah. And one of the theories is the later date of the hookah base, the more splayed the bottom becomes. This isn't quite accurate because we continue to see a variation of hukka bases throughout paintings of the 18th and 19th century. What we do see upon many bell-shaped hukka bases is a more of a variety of techniques that are deployed on the surface, such as wheel cutting, gilded work, etc. And wheel cutting is a wonderful way in which most hukka bases are decorated and then painted on top with a gilded patterning. Wheel cutting itself is a tradition that dates back for centuries in India. This is yet another example on hukka bases that we see this skill at its height. Geometric patterns as well as floral patterns were the two most common decorative motifs used on hukka bases, but it's fair to say that actually no two hukka bases that I've seen in my research are exactly identical. Many of these objects still need much further research, but it is a fascinating subject that needs to be researched much more. And as these objects become more obvious to all of us, it'll be exciting to learn and discover more about them. Thank you.